in the next, not an hour, possibly less, I will tell you about one worldwide experiment called FAST. You will hear during the remaining of the course people telling you about methods that work, methods that do not work, or methods that work sometimes. And I started that by saying usually they're not very good at predicting destruction of loops and so on. So the question is, how do we know this? And how do we test methods? And I will describe FAST to you for a couple of reasons. One is because FAST, especially for those who do not organize it. And the other reason is because FAST makes also a service to the community by testing not only the famous people and who they are in doing modeling, but also how well automatic servers perform. And since most of us do not build a model by hand every time, but use publicly available servers, it's important to know where to go to understand whether the tool you are using is reliable or not. So, FAST, believe it or not, started 20 years ago. It's an experiment that goes on every 2 years, and the aim of the experiment is to assess the techniques for both, to assess the techniques for total structure prediction. As you will see, we have expanded this concept a little bit. This is a worldwide experiment, and the aim of the experiment is to evaluate the state of the art in protein structure prediction, and as I told you, other method, other prediction topics. Ideally, we would like to identify progress, and especially to identify areas where people should put their effort because they are still lacking success. It is one important aspect of FAST is that there is a very clear and rigid separation between various groups of people. So there are the organizers, and these are past and present organizers. Then there are independent assessors. I will tell you why they have to be independent and what it means to be assessors. Then there are the predictors, and there is an infrastructure, which is called the prediction center. How does it work? So the way it works is that we go to X-ray crystallographers or NMR spectroscopies who are solving the structure but have not solved it yet. So they know that in 2 or 3 months they will have the structure, but nobody has seen the structure yet. Then we ask people to provide models. We take the sequences and we send the sequences to the predictors and ask them to deposit models of their structure. The game stops as soon as the structure is solved. So all these predictions are done when nobody has yet seen the structure. Then we involve what we call independent assessors, and I will tell you why we need assessors. It will be clear. The fact that they have this red thing here means that all this is blind, in the sense that the assessors do not know who the predictors are, and they do not know who made which prediction. Unfortunately, the predictors know who the assessors are, but that cannot be avoided. When all this is finished, so when the assessors have finished their work, we do 2 things. We tell them who are the predictors, and we open a meeting, open the subscription for a meeting, which is held in December of every given year. We don't tell the predictors who did well and who did not do well, otherwise only who wants to do well has to do it before. And so we reveal the results at the meeting, where some people get seriously upset, some other people are very happy, they make a career out of us, and some other people discover that they have a bug in their program somewhere. So in more serious terms, the way it works is that every time we start a test experiment, we have the previous the assessors change every time. So we take the previous assessors and the new assessors and we ask them to talk to each other so that they understand what your business is about. Then we collect the targets, the predictions. Then there is a bit of an issue here in deciding the categories and domains. I will get some details here. There is some automatic evaluation of the models, and then the assessors are given the results of automatic evaluation, and they proceed with their assessment. Then there is another meeting where we finally, once the assessors have decided the ranking of the various methods, then we tell them which methods they were ranking, then we are meeting, and then we publish a special issue in proteins, which is heavily distributed and so on and so forth, in fact, it is, right? We had several assessors during the years, you might recognize some names, they have assessed sometimes only once, sometimes more than once. For example, the last assessment was done by Guy Montiglione and BKD and David Jones, but we had essentially the whole community participate in one way or the other. In terms of numbers, these are the various edition of CASP. We are at CASP 10, which just was done this year, it was done in 2012. And as you can see, there are about 350 groups participating. This small drop, in fact, is not a drop, it's just that some groups joined forces. So about 350 groups, and every time we evaluate something of the order of 80,000 models, because each group submits models for several targets, even about 100 targets, so they can submit more than one model. The first question is to categorize the product. In other words, as you will hear, there are methods that allow you to predict the structure of a protein on the basis of a template that is a homologous protein. These are called template-based methods. And then there are rare cases, unfortunately, where the structure is not homologous to any known structure. We call that free modeling. The one thing that might be useful to you, if you ever want to work with structured bioinformatics, for example, is that the prediction center, and the website is www.predictioncenter.org, maintains track of all the models that ever have been submitted to CAP, all the evaluations and everything. So if you have a method and you want to test how well it does compared to other methods, you can apply your method to the CAP targets and you automatically see whether you are doing better or worse than other people. And there are a lot of things that are on the website that's really interesting. We started in 1994, and at the time the concept of format was not popular. People sent paper models of their predictions. And I always tell this story that one of the cases was somebody sent a model, and then when we discovered that this model had very, very little to do with reality, this was a plastic model made with molds of things. And then we wrote this email saying that he had left the model on the window, it was very sunny, and this is why the instruction didn't come out right. We learned that we had to force them to send stuff in the proper format. And the other thing that we learned was that we had to be very careful in the measures we use to compare different methods. Because not all the proteins are equally difficult or equally simple to model. So what we do is we take all the models for a given target, we calculate some level of quality, I will tell you which measure, and then we assign a Z-score to each thing. What that means is that we, if everybody has done a very good model, then in order to score well, we have to do an even better model. So it is compared to the average of that particular model. And then once you do this, so you assign a score to each model, which depends on how better that model is compared to the bunch of models for that protein, then we compare the results of various groups using statistical tests. Because you know you have 100 proteins, you can be lucky, 2 or 3 proteins get better, and then you can decide if your method works, but in fact it's only by chance. As I told you, we have enlarged quite a bit the number of categories that are evaluated in CAP. In fact, at the beginning we were also evaluating secondary structure prediction, and then the secondary structure prediction methods became so good that there was really no point in evaluating them. So we analyze models, three-dimensional models, in the two categories I told you about, template-based, so when there is a template, and free modeling. But we also do something else. We take the best model we receive, and we send it out. We take the model we believe is the best, because we still don't have the structure, and we send it out to people who have methods to refine models, for example, molecular dynamics, or energy utilization, or any method that they want to use. And we ask them to send back the model refined, that is possibly improved. We want to see, because the problem is that there are two communities. Community of people who are very good at making, for example, template-based models, and the community of people who are good in energy-based methods. They usually are not the same community. So by sending the model to the second community, you relieve them from the burden of having to learn how to make a good model, because if you can do a good model. Then this year we tried another thing. You might or might not know that there is a lot of discussion about the possibility of predicting residue-residue contacts between amino acids in proteins on the basis of their evolution, so on the basis of multiple sequence analysis. There's been at least one method by Chris Thunder and co-workers which has been very much discussed. They claim that they can fold proteins by first predicting the contacts between different residues and then using methods NMR-like to fold the protein. So unfortunately they need very large alignments of thousands of proteins to be able to derive correct contacts. And usually for a protein you have thousands of sequences of the time unit, you don't have no such the structure of the prison, because it must be improving everybody's interest. So that limited the possibility of testing this method. But what we did instead was that once we had the structure, before releasing the structure, we would give people some real contacts and say, now then see if by knowing a few contacts you can predict your structure better than you did before. Then there is another issue which is very relevant. As you might know, there are several databases that have models inside. There is more based by Andre Chaly, there is, I remember what is called by Dr. Fred, so databases that include pre-made models. But you need to have some way to assess how good the model is before you do it. You build the model, you have a sense of how good the model is, as you will see when template-based modeling will be described. If you take the model from somebody else, how good is it? And so, one other question we ask is, if we give you the models, can you tell us which ones you think are better? And in each model, can you tell us whether you can identify regions which are modeled properly and regions which might be wrong? This it is important to have this number. This is really essential. It would be like, if you don't have this number, it's like having glass without a scope. You get all your projects and you know which one is better and which one is worse. Then you heard this before, that there are proteins which are intrinsically disordered regions, and we would like to know whether people can predict their mutation. This is, for example, important for experimental work, because if you want to crystallize a protein, you don't want to use disordered regions that might impair the ability of the protein to crystallize. Then we also have contact prediction, that is, we give you the protein, don't want to do a model, but can you tell us which residues are in contact in the protein structure? And then we have made several attempts to try and convince people to tell us something about function. At the end, we decided that perhaps the only thing we could ask is, can you tell us whether there is a ligand binding site in the protein? You might think, once you have the model and the structure, why do you need independent assessment? Just superimpose and tell us whether the model is good or not. It's not as trivial as it might be. We have several measures to evaluate the model. I don't want to bother you with all this, but I just want to mention one thing. You are mostly, if you work in structural bioinformatics, you are mostly used to use an MSP, which is essentially this thing over here. That is the square distance between corresponding atoms, average over the protein. So for each pair of atoms, you calculate the distance, make it square, and sum it up for the whole protein. Now, this is not a really good measure of how well a model is. And I try to convince you about this, not fiction, it's not very nice. But you see, here there is a model and a structure superimposed. And as you can see, in this region, they are different. So the structure, let's say, is like this, and the model goes like this. If you calculate the RMS deviation here, what will contribute to tell you how similar model and structure are will mostly be this part here, because you square the distances, and so this will have a heavy weight on the final result. But do you really care? In other words, this region is wrong. Now, whether it's wrong and is here, or it's wrong and is a bit farther away, do you care? You don't. You care that it is farther than some distance from the real answer. So usually what you do, you use some type of cutoff, like say, tell me how many atoms you predicted within 1 angstrom, within 2 angstrom, within 4 angstrom, and so on. Which brings me to another thing, and the need for assessment, and the need for all this computation. So here is a plot where on the y-axis you have distance, and on the x-axis you have percent of residues. What this plot means is, for example, each of these lines is a prediction. Okay? So, for example, this prediction here has 40% of the residues within 1 angstrom from the real structure. Okay? And then it has 80% of the residues within 6 angstrom from the real structure.
the blue cube here, as you can see, intersects the other one. That means that it warms up to a point. Means that the lower cube has a region which is very well predicted, and another part which is not so very well predicted, while the blue cube has an intermediate quality for the overall curve. Now what do you want? Do you prefer one or the other? It's in fact difficult to say, depends. If you can predict correctly the important region of the protein and you make mistakes somewhere else, you can make. But perhaps instead, in some other cases, you prefer to have a more uniform error in your protein. So all this has to be evaluated and can only be evaluated by intervention perspective, helped by all these calculations that just have. And then we get the point. That the pre-modeling models are usually very bad. I will get to that point later. But it's very, very rare that these structures are very similar to the real model. We are still far away from that. What we want is to capture some sign of understanding of the topology. You cannot use numbers here. Because if you use numbers, every model will be bad. But there are cases where you see, well, you know, you made a mistake, but in fact you got the right orientation of the beta sheet with respect to the alpha helix, so there is hope there. So there are all sorts of complicated measures that can be used to analyze that, but in fact, at the end, the pure assessor of a free modeling is necessarily sitting in front of a screen and looking at each model one by one, by eye. Yes, thank you. Oh, sorry, I missed that.
We have both an X-ray and an MR structure, and in fact this year, the assessor for template base was Guy Montiglione, who is used to analyze NMR data, so what he did was to develop a method to extract the conserved core of the protein and only use that to compare. And method which is called fine core, which is about to be published. In X-ray, when we compare with X-ray structures, we are careful to eliminate from the evaluation regions which have crystal packing interactions, for example, or if you have more than one molecule in the asymmetric unit, we eliminate regions that are different in the two molecules, so we try and we look at the factor and stuff like that. Clearly, we compare with the experimental structure. And the experimental structure, if your model would be good, but doesn't look like the experimental structure, we cannot do anything. We have to use some methods. So, at the end of all this mess, what the whole thing comes out with is a graph like this, where there is quality on the y-axis and all the groups on the x-axis. And as you can see, there are several differences in between. This is, I think, for template based. And as you can see, these are all servers. It does make a difference if you use this server or this server in your results. So you are kindly I show you that the best service, but you know, because this thing evolves, my suggestion is before using the service, perhaps go and see whether it's one of those that can provide you with a reasonable model. So here are the best servers in the last past experiment. As you can see, there are some servers like John Server, Quark, and PMS. These are very good servers, not always up, not so user-friendly. While, for example, you probably have used or you will use HHFrag, which is as good as the others, but much more intuitive to use. If now you look at the template, non-template phase, so at the free modeling phase, and these are the things you see down here, then the quality is much better. When you see here 15, let's say, what it means is that 15% on average, 15% of the structure is within a couple of angstroms from
the real structure. And this is the average, and this is the best of that particular structure. And as you go to template-based structure, then of course numbers get much better. So, what happened to this business when we sent back the best model? And they came back with a new model. Was that model better than the one we sent? Not by much, in fact. Oops. In most cases, the improvement was by 4 at most units of GDP, which means essentially 4% of the adults getting it better. So this was not very successful from the point of view of the results. We were not very pleased. So there is a lot of space for improvement. The other question is, so people made their first model, and then we sent them this list of contacts, of real contacts, and we told them, can you improve your model now that you know these contacts? And also here the result is, the black is before and the red is after. And as you can see also here, there was not a very good improvement, there was no on the model. That means that this idea that everybody was claiming, if you give me a few correct contacts, I can predict the structure, so far has not been proven. This is instead how well people predict binding size. And this is the specificity, so this is the accuracy. And as you can see, they could predict fairly well with about 70% accuracy, and there is not much difference between the various methods. These methods usually are based on looking at multiple sequence alignment and seeing consent residues and deciding that they are the binding size. This is the same data, but by looking at the Z score, that is, by looking at who did better. And as you can see, there is a server called Firestar, developed by Alfonso Valencia, which works quite well. There is something done by Mike Press called CNI Neo, which also did decently well in predicting binding size. So all this, I don't want to bother you with linear graphs showing who is slightly better, slightly worse with each standard deviation and so on. But I strongly suggest that before using any setting for residue-residue contact prediction, for binding site prediction, for modeling, you go and look at the last issue of project, which hopefully will come out next month, to see which center you really should use. If not, you can go to the website of the prediction center and look at the results. All the presentations, all the assessors, everything is there. So you have to use, CASP is often regarded as a competition used to see who is better and who is worse. But I think it should be also used as a resource by the community, because there is a lot of effort there, both from the predictors and from the evaluators and the assessors. And again, you probably don't care whether a specific human group did better than another human group. But most of the cases, we are talking about servers, and the servers are usually put publicly available, so you can use this resource to understand what to do. Even if this is from 2007, because I don't have the similar picture for the last one, I always use this one to illustrate CASP, because it has two things that I like. The first thing is that you might notice that there are two groups in that case which did particularly well. One is the group of Zhang, and the other one is the group of David. But you can see that immediately after, there is something called Zhang Center. And I use this example to tell you that right now, template-based modeling has become a rather mature technique. And so human intervention is almost non-essential. So when there is a template and when you use appropriate methods, then doing it with the server or collaborating with Jump is more or less the same thing. In fact, in the last part, the difference is even smaller between humans and servers. And then I also use this slide to tell you another thing. So you can see that here there is group 125. This is Tassel. Just wanted to mention that in the previous edition, Zhang was a part of this group. And he did much better. He can do much better than he did working. And then there is this other issue. So the task was started by initially by John Moore. And I had this long, ever-ending discussion with John. Because John desperately tries to show that there are still problems. And he makes all sorts of complicated plots to try and demonstrate that there are still problems. These are all the CASPs, from CASP 1 to CASP 10, where here there is the average result for a given target, and the targets are sorted according to their difficulty. And this is a bit of a problem. When you compare different editions of CASP, the targets are different. So it's a bit complicated, but John has a way to measure the difficulty. And as you can see, apart from the obvious thing, that there was a jump here after the first four times. And here we can discuss, John is not here, so I can tell you the right thing. And mostly, I actually even tried to demonstrate, without convincing John, that this gap is due to two things. Better methods to detect homology, like HHMs, HHMs or stuff like that, and to an increase in the number of sequences in the database. Because even if you don't increase the structure, if you increase the sequences, then you have a better chance to obtain an accurate alignment of a family, and so the probability of having a good model is higher. In the previous CASP, until, I can't remember whether it was CASP 6 or something, we had a category called fold recognition. And fold recognition was meant for those targets. So we had targets where you look at the sequence, you do a database search, you find the template. Then we had targets where you don't find the template by sequence-based methods, like BLAST, HHMs, whatever. When you see the structure, in some cases, the structure is new, doesn't look like anything you've ever seen. In some other cases, even if the sequence didn't look homologous, you see a structure that you've already seen. So the structure is similar even if the sequence is not similar, even if you cannot detect the homology. This category has disappeared. And the reason it has disappeared is because methods to search databases and identify homologies have become so good that it's extremely unlikely that there is a structure similar to yours that you don't have. So the category has disappeared simply because of much more powerful sequence search methods. So if there is one thing in bioinformatics which has made a huge impact in everything we do has been smart methods for homology detection, mainly either macro models or profiles or profile device.
From CASP 4 or 5 on, they start to make it meta servers.
Yeah, there are meta servers. There are meta servers. So meta servers are lazy predictors. In the sense that you are a server, you send your sequence to the server, and the server sends it back to the model. But in fact, it does not do the model. It takes your sequence and sends it around to a number of other servers. Then it collects all the models, ranks them, and sends you the one that it thinks is better. And then you work better than servers. But now, in CASP, to avoid this proliferation of microphones. The problem with metacenters is that they rely on the existence of failure. And because CASP is looked at like, you know, if you do well in CASP, you will get your grant, no? So if I keep giving grants to metaservers and not to servers, this is not the reason. The servers will disappear and metaservers will not exist. So what we do is that we send the sequences to servers and then we make available all the servers predictions to everybody immediately so that everybody has the same information. And most methods from, more or less, start from a server model. There are a number of things you can play, for example, you can know that which are the servers the most likely, so some people just take the server prediction and listen later, or games like this. But essentially now, most servers are in fact meta servers, but are meta servers based on the servers that participate most of the time.
So, whatever John says, that doesn't look like a big improvement in the last few years. Of course, you know, this is a very difficult thing to evaluate. Because you could, for example, say that both in CASP 9 and CASP 10, it's true that on average everybody did the same, but there are groups that did much better than they did before. Again, the real issue is not whether or not we do models which are slightly better than previous before. The real point is, what are we missing? And I won't show you the data, but what we are missing are regions that are different from the template. So everything which does not use the template does not work properly. And the other thing is that I think there is a lot of effort that should be put into refinement, which is not doing well enough. And I also think that if the quality assessment, so if we have the method to say which are the regions that are worse and which are the regions which are better in a model, this would also simplify the work of the refinement because you could concentrate on those regions. So I think these are the areas where efforts should be made. And I think personally that this is about the time in which physics-based methods can make a difference. Because I think we've got to the limit of what can be done by knowledge-based, you know, by copies, etc. So, you know, this community, this is what we should work on, refinement of models. There is the $1 million question of how long do you want to go with this thing? You know, after 20 years, we can perhaps decide that we stop. But again, we have the jump to CASP 4 and CASP 5, perhaps there will be a jump. Every year, we have this discussion to say, should we stop? And then there is a paper appearing somewhere saying, we have a new method for doing X, Y, and Z. Okay, we cannot stop. Because suppose the new method works, then we limit it. So I don't know when we will stop. Hopefully, at one point. Now, I just want to say one more thing, and then I will stop. Fire? Is it fire? Now, the question is whether you have a
question.
Okay?
Yeah, okay.
Maybe I'll give you a time. It was a fire, a small fire. So, one important, I think, perhaps the most important effect of CASP has been to make a lot of other initiatives to CASP. So, after CASP, it came Capri, because it was initiated by George Kushner. So, and in Capri, they evaluate the ability given two proteins to find the correct orientation, so to model the complex. There is AGI to identify genes in the human genome. So what they do is that they pull out
regions of the human genome. And they ask people to identify the precise location of genes and so on and so forth. And there is, to predict the behavior of networks and define networks. One of us. Inferred networks from data or something like that. Another one is Kappa. Kappa is a critical assessment of function annotation. We go back to what we said hours ago when I started. And what we really are interested in is the structure itself, but also the correlation or the relationship of your protein with its own function. So, Kappa is another interesting experiment, which has a slightly different structure. The way it works is that it takes a large number of proteins and submits them to predictors. Predictors predict the function of all these proteins, and then everybody sleeps for a while, and after some time they go to the database and they see if any of these proteins has been experimentally annotated. Because, you know, they have a much more difficult, it's very, very difficult. It's easier to say, to ask a crystallographer, we have the crystal, we have the direct propensity map, will you solve the problem in the protein structure in 3 months? It's much more difficult to go to somebody and say, how long will it take you to understand the function of this protein? So they have to start from a very, very large number of proteins and then hope that some of this will be experimentally annotated. And there has been one Kappa experiment in 2011, and again, because they are trying to predict function, then people can submit both the molecular function and the biological process, and you can see that there are some groups like David Jones from UCSL who did particularly well in this thing. Notice, this is BLAST, so if you just remember to follow this parallelism from this point that I made before, so if you just take BLAST to assign function, you don't do very well, okay? So if you just take the first hit in BLAST and you decide that the function of that protein is the function of your protein, you do fairly badly. This year, I have accepted to assess the results of Kappa. Then I looked at it in more detail and I looked at perhaps this was a mistake. Because you see, assessing function, as I tried to tell you this morning, is very, very complex. Suppose this is your, suppose this is one part of the goal of the genotology field. Now, if this is the protein that you want to assign, first of all, you can have different domains with different functions. But then, how do you evaluate somebody? Suppose somebody predicts RNA binding, and somebody else predicts poly-G RNA binding. And then there is an experiment that shows that this protein is an RNA function. What do you do? Is this wrong? Is this right? Is this better? Is this good? So we are struggling with this and trying to find some way to come up with intelligence to assess this. But this is another experiment that you should look at. It is done, it takes longer because of what I told you, but again, if you want to have some hints about the function of your protein, look at the methods that have been assessed in Kappa. And try to use tools that be better and not to do, naive things like using BLAST and that's it. So, what did I try to tell you in this second part? First of all, I want to leave you with the impression that we know how to model proteins when we have them. We have some problems here. We still have some regions that we don't know how to predict, we still have the problem of assigning the quality score to each model, but certainly in many cases the models can be extremely useful. clearly there is the question of how good do you need the model. So the actual point is, what do you want to do with the model? Tell us what you want to do with the model. We tell you whether the quality of the model we can provide is sufficient for what you want. You want to know, where do I add my GFP, at the amino terminal salt and the carboxylate? And even a low quality model is able to answer the question. If you want to design a drug, then you better have a good quality model. And as you will hear, we have ways to know beforehand how good we expect our model to be. So you should not start from the model, you should start from the biological question. You should say, I have this biological question. I could answer this biological question with the model, provided that the model has this level of quality. And then you have to ask yourself, can I have a model of that quality, given my protein, given the results of my homology search, given all the things that you hear in this course. So I think function prediction, sooner or later, will reach the same level of accuracy as structure prediction. But please remember that methods have to be tested rigorously. The number of papers over there, out there, is infinite. And some of them, you don't use them effectively. Some others can really solve your problem. So, but before using the server, you know, don't just look at how nice the website looks. Just go and see how accurate the results have been established, not by the authors, also by the authors, but especially by the vendors. Then finally, it's interesting that computational biology, from a philosophical point of view, it's interesting that computational biology is, you know, sort of testing itself in a very open way. And, you know, if you think about it, it is challenging for somebody to test their method in such an open way that will be published and known everywhere. So even the predictors of the servers that do not do particularly well have to be praised for their willing of provide an independent assessment of their methods. And I would like to show this slide because I did talk about antibodies, and this work was done by there is Paolo Marcatilli, who just left my group. Anna Shailian is now continued by Pierpaolo and Mario Messi. And all the other stuff I told you was done, for example, by Alba Lepore, the TIPS database on the drug repositioning. While I think that all the other things you saw, like the interaction and the peptide design, were done respectively by Ernesto Vasca and Carmen Sanchez. And then I would like to forecast by that knowledge hundreds of people, including all the co-organizers, assessors, predictors, the CAP organizers, the predictors, the whole computational biology community. But I want to leave you with this message, that you have ways to see what is happening in computational biology, and you better use them, because we make a lot of effort to provide you with this information. We would like you to take advantage of all this enormous effort to calculate the many months of CASP since the beginning. It's probably more than 70% in the main. So please use the data. And that's it.